Okay, good morning. Thanks for being here and joining us all on this summery day. I'm really delighted we're all gathered to discuss Richard Epstein's latest book, The Classical Liberal Constitution, The Uncertain Quest for Limited Government. Richard, as you all know, is the Laurence A. Tisch Professor of Law. And along with his co-director, Mario Rizzo, he leads the Classical Liberal Institute here at the law school. And that institute, along with the NYU Journal of Law and Liberty, are both co-sponsoring today's conference. The Journal of Law and Liberty has built a strong reputation here at NYU among student-edited law journals and more broadly for its interdisciplinary critical exploration of classical liberal ideas. And for its part, the Institute's scope is also interdisciplinary and unified by a guiding commitment to examining the core conceptions of limited government and private property in a wide range of modern contexts, including political and corporate governance, taxation, takings, intellectual property, and different forms of regulation. The Institute has already become an important player here in our intellectual community at the law school and has contributed to a wide range of critical issues and debates in law and policy. It does have a distinctive agenda and perspective, but it shares one critical goal in common with all of the centers and institutes here at NYU, and we have many of them, and that's to encourage the kind of debate necessary for the public to make informed decisions about important issues of the day, and to help further our understanding of law and its impact on people, policy, and institutions. I think the Classical Liberal Institute is spectacularly well situated to perform those tasks, and Richard and Mario are spectacularly well suited to ensuring that it does just that. Richard, as you all know, is an incredibly productive scholar. In addition to writing dozens and dozens of articles on a wide range of legal and related subjects, he publishes a new book just about every year. And today's task, of course, is to examine his latest, the Classical Liberal Constitution. The book offers an analysis of what Richard takes to be a growing tension between adhering to a constitution whose framers insisted on limited government and more progressive ideas of government as a force for administering the social good, an idea that began to dominate American political consciousness in the middle of the 20th century. Many commentators and others divide constitutional law, constitutional commentary, into opposing groups of conservatives and progressives, or liberals in the modern sense, but Richard argues that both of these modes of thinking are flawed, with conservatives adhering to a too narrow-minded originalism and progressives espousing a too nebulous idea of a living constitution. The book offers a third approach, not libertarian per se, but classical liberal in Richard's formulation, that offers a new, although on the other hand, perhaps not entirely new, way of assessing the constitutionality of legislative action and sheds light on why, in Richard's view, the Supreme Court's current conceptual framework often fails to effectively negotiate many of our country's current legal, political, and economic issues. I think what's particularly compelling about Richard's book is the way it illuminates contemporary legal debates, whether on presidential prerogatives or on health care. It provides fresh perspectives on enduring questions surrounding the limits of government, federal and state. These, of course, are important issues with many facets to them, and debates about them will continue. We just have one day to work through them, and so we should get to it. I think the Journal and the Institute have done a wonderful job of bringing together leading scholars from across the country to join the discussion. I'd like to thank the moderators and the panelists for participating in today's event. I very much look forward to the conversation. It's now my pleasure to welcome the Classical Liberal Institute's co-director, Mario Rizzo. Mario is an associate professor of economics and co-director of the Austrian Economics Program at NYU, an adjunct scholar at the Cato Institute. He's lectured at the Institute for Humane Studies and has published numerous articles in law journals and economic journals. in addition to authoring the critically acclaimed book, The Economics of Time and Ignorance. I'm delighted to have him at our institute and pleased to welcome him to the podium. Mario.
Well, I'm not used to following a law school dean who's also a constitutional law expert at a conference on constitutional law. So I'm going to try to confuse you a little bit so with my economic knowledge, and therefore you won't see too clearly my ignorance of constitutional law. First of all, I have to say I'm happy to be here for a couple of reasons. First of all, I'm obviously looking forward to the discussion of what I believe to be a very good book and a very well-written book. It's been my companion for the past few weeks, and I have to say that it reads very well and very rapidly, especially for a book on this kind of subject. The second reason that I'm happy to be here is this book represents a kind of personal achievement for Richard. It is the culmination of many years of work on not only on constitutional law, but on many related areas, and you can see the integration of the themes in the book. But I don't want to emphasize too much this culmination idea, because I'm sure there is another book just about to come off the presses. I don't know for sure, but based on past behavior of Richard, there will be more books coming, and so we'll have to wait for the ultimate culmination. Hopefully not for a long time. I want to hold up a prop here. Okay, this is our logo, the Classical Liberal Institute's logo. All right, so now if you really understand this logo, you understand everything there is to know about the book and everything. not quite. The idea is, you see these little blocks here, they're all like moving every which way and they're looking kind of goofy and most of all happy, but yet they form a perfect square, somehow kept together by some mysterious process. Well, the mysterious process is both a legal framework, right, and the market economy. But in the classical liberal perspective, that legal framework, while important and noticeable, doesn't take away attention from the main act, which is the interaction of the individuals. All right? So that's the theory of the book. That's the theory of our organization. So now you know everything. But let me say a few more things, because the dean didn't speak for all that long, and I have to fill the time. No. Let me tell you something about how at least one kind of economist might view Richard's book and the ideas in it. I'm reminded of the contribution that the economist and psychologist Herbert Simon made about 40 years ago. He distinguished between two types of systems, one composable and the other what he called nearly decomposable. A composable system is really tight. Any change anywhere produces changes everywhere. So it's like a really tight, in economist terms, say a general equilibrium system. You move one little thing and everything in the whole system changes. A nearly decomposable system, because if it were completely decomposable, it really wouldn't be a system, but a nearly decomposable system is much looser, and parts of the system are protected from changes everywhere else in the system. In economics terms, it's sort of like Marshall's partial equilibrium, where you can study a particular industry and in more or less isolation from the rest of the economy. Now, we could imagine a constitution as a system existing in a changing environment. And so the question is, at least for me, is how is it possible to maintain constitutional coherence in the face of many and varied changes? If you think of the Constitution as a framework with three parts corresponding to the topics of the panel, structure, rights, interpretation, the question is, well, if you change one of those in any substantial way, does everything else change? Does the
system, in a sense, become unglued. So there are two questions. Are the parts of the system nearly or highly decomposable with respect to one another? And two, are the rights of the people and limitations of the state decomposable or decoupled from the rest with respect to external changes or the environment? So let me begin with the second one. Is it arguable that the rights in a sort of classical liberal system are decomposable from changes in the environment? Now, it kind of depends on how you look at it, but let me begin with this. Suppose we take a broad view of the due process clause of the 14th Amendment combined with a narrow view of the police power. Then we have something like this statement from Justice Peckham, which is quoted by Richard, something like freedom of contract to pursue the enjoyment of individual's faculties to live and work when and where he will. We can see that what this does is promotes, for example, the values of competition, free entry, and in the midst of dynamic changes of the market. It allows prices, free contract, and its consequences allow prices to convey knowledge to those in the economic system, knowledge of these changing conditions. It also provides an opportunity for mutual gains from trade, even when parties have unequal initial wealth. So in that sense, this conception of contract rights and narrow police power is robust with respect to changes in the economic environment. It applies across the board, regardless of changes in the economic environment. Second idea, broad and consistent view of the takings clause, which Richard has advocated, to include regulatory takings, provides a versatile protection from arbitrary wealth distribution from a few private individuals for general public benefits across the board, regardless of the type of a public good or environmental quality ideas that economists or public policy makers might have. It provides substantive rights against the problem of factions, in effect, or rent seeking that are decomposable with respect to the environment. Now let's move to the second question, because I want to be brief. Are the parts of the system highly decomposable with respect to one another? And this, I think, the news is not so good, at least in my view. It seems to me that if the balance of the system is disrupted, then the framework is not quite so robust. For example, let the police power be broadened and it will end up eating freedom of contract, as in the case of the federal minimum wages and hours. Take the takings clause. If it be narrowed and the use of markets to create land use structures will die the death of a thousand cuts at the hands of cultural central planners. Let the meaning of the interstate commerce be broadened, a kind of interpretation change. And the regulatory role of the federal government will expand, making government sanctioned monopoly or cartels easier to achieve, as in agricultural policy or the NIRA. Increased federal regulation almost guarantees the rise of the administrative agencies, which embody a constitutionally dubious mix of executive, legislative, and judicial functions. So in answer to our two questions, my suggestion is, but it's more a proposal for discussion, to the answer I give to how robust are classical liberal constitutional rights and state limitations with respect to changes in the environment, I would say very robust. How robust are changes in the parts of the framework with regard to each other, I would say much less so, and therefore showing the need for the integration of the interpretive, structural, and rights aspects of the Constitution, classical liberal Constitution. Okay, so those are just some ideas that occurred to me as in reading the book that relate to ideas that economists might have in mind when looking at these kinds of structures. So now I would like to stop at this role, whatever that was, and sit down and become the chairman of this session. So we've now transitioned. Thank you. Let me just say what the ground rules are. Each panelist will have about 15 minutes to speak. I will introduce people one by one, before they speak, and then go on to the next speaker and introduce the next speaker at that point. At the end of the four panelists, John Yu was not able to come. We will have some opportunity for the panelists to address each other and to discuss, and then we'll go to the audience for questions and further discussion. Okay, so I'm going to introduce people in order that they appear on the program. So the first speaker is Michael Greva, who is professor of law at GMU. He previously was a Searle Scholar at the American Enterprise Institute, and he specializes in constitutional law and business regulation, and he's the author of the recent book, The Upside Down Constitution. Michael.
Thank you. Thank you, Mario. Thanks, everyone, for the invitation. I'm very grateful, but I feel a little sheepish being here. Richard has been, as many of you know, a very dear friend and an infinitely kind and patient teacher and mentor over the past almost three decades, and I suppose that dates us. We're also occasional co-authors, but he's the team captain, and I'm in the bleachers. I should also, the case site is Taylor Swift, Bruce Tyson. I should also mention that I completely agree with Richard on the normative priors and presumptions here. It's so 19th century. And in fact, I cannot even imagine a policy disagreement with Richard. And even if I could, I wouldn't want to articulate it because none of us might hear the end of it. So I want everyone to understand this is a disagreement about among friends. And that said, I do want to articulate a basic difference in perspective among us, and it is this. I don't think this book takes the Constitution's structure seriously enough. I agree that the founders operated on Lockean presumptions, and yeah, the structure is supposed to work on those presumptions and buttress them and support them in some way, but I think the founders were somewhat more hard-nosed about the nature of that enterprise than this book. So let's start with what structure. Well, you could say, well, it's everything that isn't rights. So the provisions that parcel out powers between the branches of government or between the federal government and the states, that's all structure. And the question you then want to ask yourself is how the allocation in the Constitution coheres with classical liberal theory, and Richard asks and answers that question. There are lots of chapters on how the Commerce Clause and the tax power and so forth fits together with the theory. Here's another way of thinking about structure and rights. These are, I think, rival but complementary strategies to defend liberty. So rights guard against the risk that the people may go crazy, that government will do precisely what the majority wants, which is to exploit and oppress the losers. Structure, I think, guards against a somewhat different risk, which is that government itself may go crazy and do something people don't want it to do. So structure in that harder sense, is about agency risks, and it's about stabilizing the system. Here's why I think that matters. Anybody, I think, can draw up a classical liberal set of rights and power allocations to match. They did it in 1787 and in 1791. But that, as the founders themselves put it, is just parchment. The question is, how are you going to stabilize this system? What does it take to protect it? this is going to be a Republican government, a now, as we would now say, a Democratic government, which Richard embraces with vastly more good cheer than I can marshal. But if the Demos doesn't really believe in rights, or if the Demos starts believing in welfare rights and positive rights, then what? I think you cannot stop the people themselves, but maybe you can check their agents who separated powers and bicameralisms and checks and balances and all the rest of it. So structure in that harder, deeper sense isn't just power allocation. It's a system of auxiliary precautions and, as we now know, self-enforcing norms of incentives. And the incentives run among and between all the three branches, as well as vertically between the feds and the states. It's in that sense that the Constitution is a Bill of Rights. And I think it's that part, the structure in that sense, that is the founders' real discovery and contribution. In a lot of ways, the Lockean background was and remains an old hat. Now, of course, Richard knows all that. He has 6 very fine pages on it. It appears under preliminaries, pages 21 to 27. But then I think as the book progresses, I think the structure disappears and the model of government that takes its place is something else entirely, and it's the public corporation. So we, the people, become shareholders. Government becomes a management with a board of directors, which may exercise business judgment but not start redistributing stuff among the shareholders. And when the management misbehaves, there's the court, in this case the Supreme Court. This isn't just a metaphor, I think, for Richard. He mobilizes the analogy to figure out standing rules and the standard of judicial review, which is the business judgment rule, and other key questions. Here's the disagreement. I don't think, actually, the corporation analogy is particularly helpful. I think, descriptively, a criminal enterprise is a much closer comparison. And I think, analytically, the structure of corporations and governments is just simply isn't the same. For a million reasons, it can't be. So it's a little bit like James Buchanan writing on clubs. The analogy may be useful as a sort of starting point to think about basic questions, but sooner or later, you have to give a systematic account of the differences. The difference I want to focus on or talk about for a few minutes is the Supreme Court. I do not think that it's very useful to analogize the Supreme Court to the Delaware Chancery Court. For one thing, the Chancery isn't really shareholders' principal protection. Voting isn't either. What is their protection? It's exit. That's not really an option when you're talking about the national government and not really a helpful way of thinking about it. So who or what controls the government management? Not voting either. I think that's mostly the problem and not the solution. So it's got to be the Supreme Court. And I think that is really asking an awful lot. And second, the Supreme Court is not an independent third actor who's sort of chosen almost by contract. It's a branch of government. And yet throughout this book, the Supreme Court looks like this deus ex machina who has messed up a lot of things, but only if only these people could think right about it, they'd be benign. You see this orientation sort of away from the structure and toward a court-centered model in the organization. So after preliminaries comes a part that's called constitutional structures, as if there's more than one of them. And it goes like this: 1, the judicial power; 2, the legislative power; 3, the executive power. Needless to say, that's not the way the Constitution is organized. I think it's very hard to read the document as saying first comes the Supreme Court with judicial review, which is going to ensure that nobody else does anything stupid. The part on judicial power then starts not as sort of a structurally oriented theorist might with the grants of jurisdiction or the weird way in which the court system is organized, but it starts with judicial review. It then joins that theme with arising under jurisdiction. That chapter I found actually quite striking. With really admirable candor, Richard says that, well, Marbury actually envisions a fairly limited judicial role, and he thinks that Martin versus Hunter's lessee may actually have been wrong as an originalist matter. And then he says, that's all water under the bridge. What with Cooper and Aaron and modern federal question jurisdiction, the prescriptive constitution says it's judicial supremacy all the way and across the board. There then follow two chapters on standing to sue and on the rather arcane political question doctrine, and that's part two. I think it's really telling that the standing analysis occupies such a central place here. The gist of it, as I understand it, is that we should understand standing along the corporation model. So you own a share, meaning you're a taxpayer, and you can sue. Article 3, Article 2 considerations are completely irrelevant to that analysis. The take care clause is simply a distraction, and Article 3 doesn't matter either. This is a bit of shadow boxing. Richard and I have had this conversation several times, and I'd be happy to go one more round, but I just want to point out how expansive Richard's position is. It means that when Marshall asks, one, does he have a right to the commission? That's completely beside the point for purposes of jurisdiction. Marbury just happened to be closest to the scene, and so he gets to sue the Secretary of State of the United States, regardless of whether he has a vested right, regardless of whether this was a discretionary act or not, the structural Article 2 issues are irrelevant. It also means that so long as you pay taxes, and maybe even if you don't, any federal expenditure is open to challenge in federal court any day of the week. That is no longer dispute resolution or departmentalism, which I think is the structural position that would go with this. It's law declaration to the max. I don't think it's even fairly described as judicial supremacy anymore. This is a council of revision. Now, why take that position? And I think if you want to carry the classical liberal program through, you almost have to take that position for reasons that get you back to structure and rights. If you believe in structure in a sort of hard sense as a system of incentives, what you'll think is you think you can bias the system towards classical liberal outcomes, but you can't guarantee those outcomes. Even with judicial review, it'll still be true and still be the case that most constitutional norms, rights, power allocations will go under-enforced most of the time. That just comes with this territory. For starters, the legislature will spend on anything for which there is demand, because that is what legislatures do for a living, and those decisions will mostly go unreviewed. Now you can ask yourself, why would anybody want to run that risk? The answer is you need the powers, and review by an outside and unelected force outside the structure would be even riskier. So there you are. But when the structure then fails to do what you want it to do, which is to produce limited government, and you want to close the gap between the classical liberal constitution and our miserable existence, you'll take the step that Richard takes, which is you need a council of revision armed with just the right doctrines. I think at the end of the day, I understand that impulse, but I think this court-centered and rights-centered model is very hard to square with the actual constitution, perhaps not in its normative orientation, but it certainly in its institutional thrust. Just a few closing remarks. What's the argument for running the classical liberal program this way? I can see four. One, it's normatively attractive, at least to me. Two, it's very useful to think of what the constitutional rules would look like if reality were to comply for a change. Three, and I think this is central, it's obvious that the founders hope and structural checks and balances have been disappointed. partly because they got parts of the analysis right, but partly and mostly for reasons they couldn't foresee. So structure in that sense is gone. And this may be just the flip side, we're living in a court-dominated universe anyhow, so it's going to be their rights or ours, which is it going to be. I think that fight is also over, and everyone knows who's won. The New Deal is a done deal, and so is this lurch into postmodern mores, if that's still the word. So my question to Richard, and it really is a question, at least for practical purposes, might it be possible to improve the situation by focusing on structural matters that are beyond the scope of this book? Second best rules, and what you might want to call the Constitution's plumbing. So here's an example of what I have in mind. I don't think either the Commerce Clause or the Takings Clause is going to be much use to men of commerce anytime soon. But more sensible federal preemption rules would. Overruling Erie Railroad would be very useful. So maybe Hart and Wexler had this right all along. Everything that happens, or everything that matters, happens in the weeds. And I think the added advantage of playing in that universe is that in contrast to these brawls about God, guns, and gays, down there in the weeds, legal arguments still count, at least occasionally. I think I know Richard's answer, which is something along the lines, or I'll just guess. Look, Griever, you can't hope to get that stuff right unless you first figured out the big picture. And my answer to that is what it usually is. Richard, I agree completely.
Okay, thank you. Our second speaker is Aziz Huq, who is a professor of law at the University of Chicago. He specializes in constitutional law, natural security, counterterrorism, human rights. He's also the author of a book called Unchecked and Unbalanced Presidential Power in a Time of Terror. Today he'll be speaking on libertarian separation of powers.
Thank you, Mario. I first started learning seriously from Richard Epstein in my first week as an assistant professor. He came down the hall from his office to mine at the University of Chicago and sat down and offered his advice on strategies for succeeding pre-tenure. The key to tenure is simple, said Richard. You need to improve in quantity and quality. Pause. Exponentially. I thought about asking him which exponent he meant, but thought that there are some questions best left unasked. Exponentially would serve as a good epithet for the classical liberal constitution, which ranges across more legal questions than most scholars have occasion to teach, let alone to study or to engage with. So this commentator, at least, is perforce humbled. And notwithstanding Richard's wise advice, I have been unable to keep up with his breadth of erudition and scholarship, and so of necessity, my contribution engages only indirectly with his larger project on a single point. One element of the larger project in the classical liberal constitution is the derivation from classical liberal principles and, I think it's fair to say, a set of strong libertarian priors of answers to constitutional questions about structure, about the separation of powers in particular. And in this regard, the classical liberal constitution, whatever its other heterodoxies, shares a common intuition with much of our constitutional jurisprudence. The idea that we can derive an account of second-order structure from a vision of first-order values, a set of first-order goals. Now, this idea is deeply rooted in our constitutional tradition, and it's reiterated with some frequency today. So when Madison finds a remedy for tyranny in the division of federal powers, he's engaged in this sort of logic. When Justice Kennedy in 2011 argues in United States versus Bond that, quote, individuals, too, are protected by the operation of the separation of powers and checks and balances, he again is enunciating the same constitutional truism. Notice, though, a threshold ambiguity. It is not clear precisely when structural constitutional principles ought to be derived from primary goods. Do they matter only for the designer of a constitution, or ought they also to be accounted for in the same fashion at a retail level by judges filling in the interstices of a given constitutional framework? After all, in the passage I just alluded to, Madison was describing the general task of articulating a constitutional text, and he was not directing how specific elements in that text ought to be glossed. It's a simple fallacy of division to reason from the former to the latter. So whatever level we choose to understand the linkage between primary goods and second-order constitutional structure, we ought to ask a question about what mechanism is operating to bridge those two ideas, or those two, the set of values with a set of legal principles. How might we go about exploring the efficaciousness of such mechanisms? Well, consider the following thought experiment. Let's imagine a constitutional founder who values a single primary good, the primary good of liberty. And let's also imagine a glossator of the Constitution, somebody who's responsible for interpreting and implementing the Constitution, who also has a single primary good that they care about. Again, this primary good is liberty. Let's ask whether that designer, whether that interpreter, implementer of the Constitution, can consistently reside to a single structural strategy. Is there a single election of constitutional structure that follows from a single-minded choice of primary goods that a constitution is supposed to promote? If there are multiple elections, multiple plausible choices that emerge at the structural level from the choice of a singular public, a singular goal, primary good, that a constitution is supposed to produce, we might start to wonder whether there is such a thing as a singular libertarian separation of powers. So we can start the thought experiment at a very high level of generality. Start with the molar question that a constitutional designer must answer, of whether it's preferable to have some form of elected or otherwise democratic government or an authoritarian regime, a dictatorship. Now, I take it that that seems, on its face, the least likely place to plant some skepticism. But consider the following hardly exceptional possibilities. The idea that dictatorship in some circumstances is the only means available to prevent a vociferous collection of subnational entities from collapsing into internecine warfare. Or consider the possibility that a supermajority of a territorial unit's population has dirigiste and redistributive preferences. Now, to be sure, either of these circumstances might be proffered as a subterfuge to hide more sinister ambitions. But it is hardly clear from the historical data points that we have at our disposal that each time one of these arguments is offered as a mea culpa by an authoritarian regime, it is necessarily a sham, it is necessarily a pretense, or necessarily incorrect. Now, I suspect that arguments on behalf of authoritarianism will seem outlandish to many, and perhaps that last argument is best seen as a provocation and little else. But when we go one level of detail, one level of generality down, the libertarian priority, I think, provides us with still uncertain guidance. Take the choice that a constitutional designer has, a democratic constitutional designer now, between parliamentary and presidential forms of government. If libertarian goals are our benchmark, we might think of three margins along which that choice might be analyzed. We might think about the margin of political stability, we might think about the margin of fiscal responsibility, and we might think about the margin of political and social political rights, let's say. Along each of those three margins, though, the empirical evidence with respect to the effects of that choice are ambiguous, dramatically so in some instances. So with respect to political stability, there is a large and long-running debate, starting with a very famous article by Juan Lintz, concerning the respective merits of presidential and parliamentary systems. The literature is divisive. It's not clear which way one ought to come out based upon the data that's currently available. Perhaps more interestingly, on the fiscal responsibility front, there are clear lessons. The clear lesson is that parliamentary systems tend to spend more and hence require larger taxation bases than presidential systems. However, data on sovereign defaults demonstrates that parliamentary systems are less likely to default on their debts than presidential systems. Finally, as to political liberties, the liberal demarches against the Bush administration notwithstanding, there's at least some evidence at the international comparative level to suggest that presidential systems do a better job at protecting civil liberties than parliamentary systems. So if we're interested in empirics and we want to go beyond the homiletic nostrums of our slaveholding precursors with respect to the springs of liberty, the election between parliamentary and presidential systems becomes less than self-evident. Now, finally, if we turn from the constitutional designer to her colleague, the constitutional interpreter, we find no less ambiguous lessons. Separation of powers jurisprudence famously forks into two separate tributaries, formalist and functionalist in nature. The trouble for our purposes is that neither of these two modes of interpretation reliably yields the libertarian answer. Sometimes, as Richard points out, formalism will generate the correct libertarian answer. The pending Noel Canning case with respect to recess appointments is an example of this. But sometimes functionalism may serve the libertarian better. An example of that might be the Bauscher v. Sinar case about the budgetary lockbox from the mid-1980s. All the way down, then, the putatively simple connection between one single primary good, liberty, and structural constitutional choice is, in fact, ambiguous. And in this light, we can understand better, perhaps, a singular and surprising move that's made at the beginning of the classical liberal constitution. That move concerns methodology, the methodology of interpreting the constitution. And it's Richard's embrace of, for him, I think, a surprisingly eclectic mix of hermeneutic methods, including text, what he calls historical context, constitutional prescriptions, the intellectual heritage of the framers, and although he doesn't say this, I think it's fair to add, the pragmatic consequences of given decisions. At least when it comes to structural constitutionalism, I think, such eclecticism might indeed be warranted for the libertarian constitutionalist, if one has, that is, a singular priority in terms of the primary goods expected from a constitution. For as Richard could have told us 30 years ago, those who seek to promote a just measure of liberty may often be better off talking just about liberty. Thanks.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Richard Pildes, who is professor of constitutional law at the NYU Law School. Of course, he specializes in constitutional law, but also in democracy and the law and election law. He's the co-author of a book called The Law of Democracy, Legal Structures, and the Political Process. Richard.
Thank you very much, and thank you to Richard in particular for inviting me to participate in this panel. Since Richard is a colleague of mine. I think I'm the only one who's officially a full-time colleague of Richard's on the panel at the moment. I just wanted to start off saying a couple of words about Richard as a person. Those of you who know him will know this. Those of you who may not know him should hear this, especially if you're out there in the internet somewhere. So Richard has a tremendous vitality in intellect that is still completely overwhelming, even at a stage of his career at which many other people have chosen to slow down. He's certainly as vital as anybody I know in the Legal Academy and anybody on my faculty, including people who are 40 years younger than him, which I'm not. But that's a well-known feature of Richard, and it's particularly evident in this book because what Richard has done here is not just pull together things he's written in the past and sort of synthesize them into some culminating statement, but he's pushed himself to think more systematically about areas that he has not written about nearly as extensively before, in particular the issues I want to talk about today, which are the separation of powers issues in the book. Richard is also very well known, as has already been remarked, for his tremendous generosity on a personal level. And I want to give an account of how I benefited from that before I make my remarks, a little bit similar to Aziz's story, I suspect. I think he'll think it is. So actually, the very first job I interviewed for in the Legal Academy was at the University of Chicago when Richard was chairman of the Appointments Committee. And I thought that when one goes through this process, one should be very careful to only speak about the things you really have deep knowledge about. And not risk coming across as sort of expounding on things you had no right or entitlement or substantive knowledge that was deep enough to really talk about. I didn't get a job at the University of Chicago, and Richard called me up and said, listen, do you want me to tell you what went wrong and how you should think about this process? Because he was a supporter of mine back then. And I said, yes, absolutely. I certainly want to benefit from that. And Richard said, the problem is you would only talk about the things you actually know something about. You know, you have to learn to just speak about everything. Faculty wants someone who will talk about anything. Now, I leave it to you to figure out whether that reveals more about Richard or the University of Chicago or the Legal Academy or me. But I did follow his advice, and here I am. So I am a direct beneficiary of Richard's generosity, and I wanted to thank him in public for that, as well as his willingness to be teased mercilessly by me over the years. All right, now, to talk about the separation of powers contribution of this book, one of the things that I think is actually quite interesting is that when Richard turns his mind to the question of whether what the classical liberal tradition has to say about the separation of powers, he actually concedes, I think, that it has very little distinctive to say about the separation of powers. He says this in a number of places in the book. As a normative matter, this is a quote, the classical liberal approach praises the effort to divide powers, but it has little to say, which is no different from any rival theory, and I agree, as to how those powers are to be divided. Or the separation of powers is conceptually underpowered, he says. It only requires some division of authority to slow down the pace of regulation. Or my favorite line of his on this point, classical liberal theory cannot pull rabbits out of hats. The choice of structural divisions of power is always harder to articulate than the theory of rights that those structures are intended to correct. And in addition, Richard recognizes that the strategy he tries to draw on through much of the book, which is to build on private law understandings and practices for thinking about public institutions, is also an unavailing kind of strategy here for various reasons, including the fact that corporations not only do not have anything like the separation of powers that structures American government, but the board of directors can fire the CEO of a corporation. The president cannot be fired. That's part of the basic structural choice in the American system. And that in and of itself kind of pulls the rug out, as Richard recognizes, I think, from any strategy for reasoning about the structure of our political institutions from the private sphere in the way Richard likes to in other parts of the book. So for a sort of general conceptual vision of the separation of powers, Richard is left to fall back on, understandably, I think, the fairly familiar, vague, general formulations that are typically framed with respect to how the Constitution was designed and how to justify this design. And so he says things like the classical liberal tradition believes in both the separation of powers and checks and balances. It praises the effort to divide powers or to slow the process down by dividing power across institutions, but it can't really say very much more beyond that at a broad kind of conceptual or theoretical level. Now, his book, of course, is written as a book about American constitutional law, and it's understandable that, of course, he works from within the ideas, the basic institutional structures, the text, the established doctrines, to puzzle through various discrete issues in the separation of powers, which is what the book does. His project is fairly internal, in that sense, to the basic design of the Constitution. But as others on the panel have already done, the discussion has prompted me to try to think more generally about the organization of governmental powers and to ask questions from a more external perspective. I want to do this also in the spirit that Aziz pursued this inquiry, which is to accept to some extent the underlying sort of premises or viewpoint of classical liberalism and then to think about structures of government that might follow. I don't agree, of course, with Richard in his resistance to the modern welfare state or the various forms of New Deal government oversight of the economy, but the Madisonian fear of faction that much of Richard's book is organized around and his critique of democracy is certainly a powerful one and an ongoing concern in all democracies with respect to the capacities of small, well-organized, intensely interested, concentrated, and well-resourced groups to extract various kinds of rents from the democratic state. Now, from that perspective, I want to suggest that a classical liberal should actually be much more critical of the system of separated and diffused powers that we have. Democratic systems can be carved up by rent-seeking factions. That was always the fear of Madison and of many democratic theorists. It's been a reality that we've had to deal with modern democratic government. And yet the greatest protection against that sort of rent-seeking capacities of tendencies and motivations of private, well-organized and concentrated groups is in fact a much stronger central government than the classical liberal tradition or the design of American institutions actually provides. And this is really an extension of a well-known point in the literature on political parties and political science world from people like Nelson Polsby or Walter Dean Burnham. Strong political parties are essential because they provide the most effective means, the most powerful concerted organizations to stand up against the inevitable forces of rent seeking by powerful, well-organized private groups. The more individual office holders are isolated, the more they have to stand on their own for election or in various other ways, rather than being part of an effective, concerted organizational structure, the more those officials will inevitably develop relationships of dependency with powerful actors who can make or break their careers. What would it mean to take this insight that about political parties to the broader level of the design of democratic institutions? It should make us think more, as Aziz already alluded to, about parliamentary structures. And as an ideal type, I want to suggest a parliamentary structure that has a kind of closed list proportional representation system for elections. That sort of system, completely the opposite of the diffused checks and balances system we reflexively celebrate in the United States, generates the most concerted political parties, the most concerted and organized public forces in government. Now, of course, there are plenty of disadvantages and costs to that system as well, as all democratic systems, of course, do have their own costs and benefits. And one obvious cost of a closed list PR system is the loss of the sense of an individual representative that you choose, that in some sense you view as directly accountable to you. But I put that out there as an ideal type kind of contrast to the system that we have to force us to think a little bit more beyond the cliches about the values of checks and balances and diffused political powers, to ask questions about a system in which we have individual election districts with various constituencies, which creates various veto points, more veto points in the system of American government than any other. And each of these veto points is not merely a means of blocking government action, which is the way we tend to talk about these veto points, but also a means of extorting or manipulating democratic processes for various rent-seeking private kinds of interests. We know this, or at least Richard knows this, when he draws on private law in other areas of the book. So for example, when he talks about local government, land use regulation, development process, and the like, he realizes that every opportunity for permitting or regulation or approval and the like constitutes, particularly in corrupt systems, an opportunity for bribes, and in less corrupt systems, various kinds of extractions that follow that may not take the form of actual bribery. But that's exactly what a system of diffused political powers at the national level does. In a sense, our system is designed as a kind of anti-commons for governance. All of the points of veto, all of the points of blockage become opportunities for deals to be made in terms of special benefits directed to particular well-organized interests. Or turn back to the corporate analogy that Richard does like to draw on. Could we imagine, or what would it be to imagine, a successful business structure run with the kind of separations of powers that we have in American public governance? The separation between the board of directors and the management is nothing like the separation and division and diffusion of power that we have within political institutions. So, of course, we want constraints of various sorts on political power. The most important is independent judicial interpretation of the laws and perhaps judicial review in the constitutional sense. But that's a different question from the question of how we divide up, or whether we should divide up, political power between executive and legislative institutions, and carve up legislative institutions even further into the kind of bicameral structure that we have. Moreover, we get far less benefit out of this division of power powers across these institutions than we tell us in our more romanticized accounts of democracy, precisely because these institutions of government don't function as independent judgment centers in government, the House, the Senate, the presidency. They are deeply linked by partisan affiliations in the world of modern political party organization. And so the House or the Senate, controlled by the same president, by the same party as the president, provides very little of the checking and balancing function in the idealized or traditional Madisonian account in a world before political parties were recognized or existed. So we have a lot of the costs of highly diffused powers, with all of the opportunities, all of the greasing of the wheels that's required for government to actually act. And we may not be getting nearly the benefits of carving up political power in these ways that we think. So maybe the right way to think about the issues of classical liberalism and structures of government, once we get past the glittering generalities about limited government, diffusing power, checks and balances, and the like, is that there are actually quite profound trade-offs here between different risks of democratic governance that shape democratic design choices. Richard seems to be primarily worried, maybe that's not fair, equally worried about majoritarian biases, as he calls them, in a democratic system. And I suppose if you focus on that worry alone, if that's the only dimension of worry, maybe fragmenting political power in the conventional American way is appealing. But the cost of doing that is all of these channels through which concentrated, powerful, strongly self-interested, rent-seeking entities are able to penetrate the political system with individualized office holders who both need those interests, need to respond to those interests, and don't have nearly the capacity to stand up against them. So as Aziz did, I wanted to suggest that the celebration in Richard's book of the standard checks and balances, diffused political power story that characterizes our system is understandable from within the context of a book written to try to explain and criticize specific doctrines in American constitutional law. But I want to raise the larger question of whether that strategy formed in an era with less sophistication about the capacity for government to be carved up in these ways by private groups is really the ideal strategy for designing democratic institutions. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, with all that talk about public choice, it's a good segue into our next speaker, Richard Wagner, who's professor of economics at George Mason University. He's written and contributed widely to the public choice and constitutional political economy literature. He's the author of, at least in my book, a classic work with James Buchanan, Democracy and Deficit, the Political Economy of Lord Keynes. More recently, he has written Deficits, Debt, and Democracy, Wrestling with the Tragedy of the Fiscal Commons. Richard.
Thank you, Mario. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm pleased to be here. If you don't mind, I prefer to stand when I talk, although it puts me farther away from my notes and my eyes are getting weaker, and so I realize I may be missing something. But I guess I'm the only economist on this panel, and so the only thing I know about law, I suppose, was back in 1979. I went to one of Henry Manny's summer camps for law for economists in Key Biscayne, where we had 3 weeks with Roger Crampton, Laurence Friedman, and Jerry Mashaw. And other than that, I read journal articles and books, including Richard's books on occasion. But I look upon my presentation as offering a kind of flying buttress to what Richard talks about. I accept the basic orientation towards classical liberalism that he sets forth, but I titled my remarks Richard Epstein's Classical Liberal Constitution, What Might Benjamin Franklin Have Thought? Why Benjamin Franklin, you might ask? Well, I have in mind that reference that he was reportedly asked upon leaving the Constitutional Convention, what kind of a constitution had you all created? And he responded, a republic if you can keep it. Now, in thinking of that, that means in turn that Franklin was a kind of an evolutionary theorist, as it were. That just because something was kept at one time doesn't mean it's going to continue in force. It can change. And it can change for two, you might say, sets of or categories of reason. And it also points, since, as I say, I'm offering a flying buttress, my bailiwick, of course, is public choice, political economy, and so forth, and not law, that it points to a dichotomy in terms of ways of conceptualizing or approaching economic processes, or market processes, or social processes. On the one hand, there's a conceptualization that runs in terms of closed determinist systems, and there's a conceptualization that runs in terms of open-ended processes. And I bring up Franklin because my mind was triggered in this way not so long ago in reading a paper by Ross Emmett, who asked the question, what would Frank Knight have thought about George Stigler and Gary Becker's De Gustibus Non Est Disputandum, which was the Stigler-Becker claim that economic theory should proceed as if preferences were invariant across time and through space, and everything reflected some kind of change in relative costs as a theoretical exposition. And so Emmett asked this question, and the interesting thing about that was that Frank Knight died 5 years before Stigler and Becker wrote their piece. Now, of course, there's lots of records there about what Frank Knight thought about things, how he approached things, and so what Emmett engaged in was a kind of an imaginary act of what Knight would have written in response to the Stigler-Becker formulation. And I thought about that in that context in terms of Richard's book and the what would Benjamin Franklin have, how might he have responded in that same fashion to the classical liberal constitution in light of a republic if you can keep it, because what Richard tells is a story of the movement away from the liberal republic that was created. And that in turn raises the question of, well, what might an economist say about that movement away? And I think there you can come across one of those proverbial forks in the road. Down one fork, you have the Stigler-Becker kind of story of inevitability of changes in relative costs and prices that led to a movement, what you might call, some economists might call, a Pareto-efficient movement away from the classical liberal republican constitution. Down another fork of the road would lie the Frank Knight open systems kind of articulation that would say that at any one moment there were open several historical possibilities. One possibility was chosen, and so what you have is something that resembles one of those tree-like processes where at any instant there is in front of you a number of historical possibilities. Later, one of those possibilities is chosen, and that in turn opens new possibilities into the future, and on we go. And so after a number of moves down the branches, you can find yourself far distant from where you might have been had a series of choices been made. Now I want to, so that dichotomy then in terms of the literature with which I'm familiar, in terms of the literature on economics, constitutional political economy, and so forth, the first, I suppose, major work in constitutional political economy was the Buchanan and Tullis Calculus of Consent, published in 1962. Now there, they made a very sharp distinction or cleavage between a process of selecting the rules of the game, so to speak, and the choice, subsequent choice of strategies by which to play that game. And I think for some purposes that's a useful way of thinking about things, but it also channels your thought in ways that sometimes aren't very helpful, because you know, much of that literature used the image of a kind of a parlor game. A bunch of people get together to play poker. Well, if you're playing poker, first of all, everyone is there because they agree to, and they agree on what kind of poker they're going to play, what the betting limits are going to be, and these kinds of things. And if someone later in the evening wants to switch the game, change the betting rules, they can discuss it and agree to or not. And if you don't like it, you can even go home. But that's not, of course, the scheme of things within which political, what we refer to as political constitutions operate, because they're, we're not in this sequential world where first you choose rules, then you play by the rules, then you perhaps stop the play and then amend the rules, but rather you're in a continual ongoing process where both some margins of action deal with choices within the rules, other margins of action deal with trying to change and influence those kinds of rules, and they all go on together. Now, so within that kind of framework of rules and actions, both in Shruti Rajakopalan sitting over here and there in the on your far right in the second row, and I just put an advertisement, had a paper in the Constitutional Political Economy not long ago, trying to expound some of that. That perhaps the one in this respect of the simultaneity of changes in rules and choices of actions, although Richard dates the demise or the withering away, you might say, the classical liberal constitution from 1937, I might just remark that one of my favorite works in this on this whole topic was a little book published in 1932 by Charles Warren called Congress of Santa Claus. And what Warren did was recite the history of basically congressional interpretation for the most part of the general welfare clause of the Constitution, from which was originally interpreted as meaning and believed to mean that Congress can't appropriate unless the appropriation is pretty much for everyone's benefit, as a general welfare clause might suggest, and how over the years through successive legislative sessions that finally became increasingly understood to mean, well, just whatever a sufficient number of members of Congress think is for the general welfare. And so, you know, I think this process of erosion goes back far further than 1937. It's probably been going on from day one, because that's, I think, also a feature of human nature, is always to have an unduly fond appetite or appeal for what is of particular interest to us. How else could it be? That in that response, for instance, I'm very much influenced. It comes from Isaiah Berlin. He wrote a book that carried the title The Crooked Timber of Humanity, but that was a gloss on Immanuel Kant's From the Crooked Timber of Humanity, No Straight Thing Has Ever Been Made. And I think that's an important consideration. But we're talking about a relationship between democracy and liberty, or democracy and liberalism. And I think what we have there basically are two systems of human governance. How do people relate to one another? What are the procedures by which relationships are governed? And you might say that the basic kind of market governance is a consensual kind of governance within a framework of private property rights. And then on the same society, you have a subset of activities that are governed by private property or private ordering, and then you have a subset of activities that are governed through some kind of political ordering process. Now, you might ask, well, what is the nature of that political ordering process? And here's where it gets very sticky or very tricky, because there is no one unique political ordering process. Because first, when you talk about private order, and basically you're talking about people and private property and putting together the kinds of agreements that people choose to put together. And as Richard said in a different work earlier on simple rules for a complex world, that very complex organizations can be put together through a framework of these very simple rules of property and contract. But when we get to the public sphere, you might ask, well, what we have then conceptually is a world of private property and a world of public property. Then you ask, well, how do they, since they're in the same space, how do they cohere? Well, that's a good question. I think they cohere very tectonically. By tectonically, I mean the geology of plate tectonics. There are regions where public property and private property and their various claims come into conflict, collide, and that generates further social debris that sets in motion, I would say, just a continual evolutionary process. Now, if we're then going to think about, then the relation between democracy and liberty or liberalism is then bound up in how you're going to have these connections taking place between public and private ordering, which puts, I think, important work upon the structure through which public ordering is constituted. Because if you talk about structure, if you talk about networks, I think, to an economist, at least of my type, that puts you in the world of networks. You're theorizing about network kinds of activities, constitutional processes involve networks. Now, if you think about a network, you probably all have seen these kinds of configurations where you have, oh, say, little circles called nodes. Think up on the board there, all kinds of nodes. You could say those are people or organizations. And then secondly, you draw connections amongst those nodes in various ways. Those lines in the graph theory from which these ideas come, those lines are called edges. So you have nodes and edges. What that means is that to carry public projects forward, you need to traverse some kind of path that connects various kinds of nodes and edges to get the results you want, with different kinds of governmental structures, then having different kinds of properties to it. Now, there's a lot of differences from the world of 1789 or 87 and our present world that have, you know, like say in a positive explanatory fashion, the world hasn't stood still. We would expect many things to play out differently that might in turn, in even the maintenance of liberal constitution, might require changes in adaptation to these changing circumstances. For instance, well, Richard made some comments about political parties here, but apparently at the original constitutional stage, founder fathers didn't anticipate political parties. Those were a shortly to come later development. There's also apparently some evidence that at that time they thought the vice president would be the second most popular politician in the land that would create a different kind of dynamic from what we have. Back then you had front-loading muskets and cannon that were only fairly accurate that might give Madison had some things about the importance of guns to a program of constitutional maintenance that probably made more sense back then than it does now in terms of modern armaments. We know a whole lot more about political kinds of processes that I think have some good things to say about parliamentary representation kinds of systems. One of the things with a two-party system is that coalitions are formed prior to an elections and tend to be very firm, which I think also tends to lead to political dialogue that is highly heuristic in its tenor. Like if you look at people who give media training, they say the first thing you do if you're on a media interview is never answer a question. You always go into an interview with a message point. And whatever question you're asked, you turn that into getting over your message, because it's your message that counts. And that's, I think, part of the heuristic character of two-party dialogue, whereas perhaps in multi-party systems, at least potentially, where coalitions can have fluidity about them, room for change, there may be more room for genuine discussion and analysis. And let me just say one thing in closing beyond that, that this idea of factions has been talked about this morning in a number of cases. And it's one of those probably irremediable features of human nature, I'll say for sure. But suppose you have economist has to do something with a model, like we can't help ourselves, I suppose. But suppose you have a simple model of 1,000 people, to keep the numbers small, each of whom is what we might call more or less indifferent between, say, two candidates or two programs. That could be modeled as flipping a coin. And then in there you say, well, suppose there are just a faction of 50 who act in unison within that scheme of things. Well, with the basic binomial properties of that scheme, that faction will be able to dominate the results 80% of the time. Now, if that faction is of size 75, it'll get its way 99% of the time. Where that all leads in terms of classical liberalism, I don't know. I think as an economist, I'd say that in terms of the positive economics of constitutional development, there are two things in play. One is the immoral imagination. It gets back to that crooked timber of humanity. But how do you characterize political power? I think it's fair to say that at the time of the American founding, political power was probably regarded as a kind of Faustian bargain with the devil, that it was represented a use of instruments of evil forced over other people that was used because it was hoped that where it was used, more good would come than harm, because it was at that time used in a relatively limited way in terms of some specification of limited powers, plus a structure of government that had both a separation of federal powers and also had a very robust federalist system, including a federalist system where the federal Senate was composed of a council of states, as it were. And so that's a different kind of system, but that perhaps conformed to the Faustian bargain. Now, I've sometimes wondered, if someone were to do a kind of a Gallup poll type of thing, that do you agree that government power is a Faustian bargain imposed into society? I expect these days you wouldn't get a 99-1% kind of division, because there is no fundamental division between the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists in debating whether or not to ratify the Constitution. But I think you would find something very different now, which means that the moral imaginations in play are very different today than they were then. Now, an open question, I think, is to what extent the moral imaginations themselves are influenced by politically organized practice, and that we have increasingly as perhaps a practice that, for better or for worse, takes away from people the need to exercise what Tocqueville in places called the cares of having to live daily and manage your lives. So I think that the immoral imaginations are an important thing to be dealt with and take into consideration. But so too are cognitive kinds of issues and performance properties of different kinds of systems, which happens to be why I also am highly interested in things like proportional representation systems, further revised, strengthened kinds of federal assistance, because I think this, I think it is, in fact, the case that the use of force is an evil instrument in society. It's not going to go away, but I think it's not something to be glorified either. Thank you.
Okay, before we get to questions and discussion from the audience, I'd like to give the panelists some opportunity to react to one another or to argue or whatever they'd like to do. Who would like to go first? Michael.
Me first?
Yeah, why not?
I don't want to argue. It's just one sort of added thought or maybe collection of thoughts, starting with Richard's comments, much of which I agree with. One of the things that we haven't talked about, but where a lot of this plays out, I think, is administrative agencies. We haven't said much about that, but that's sort of big separation of powers and operation of government theme. You face the same the same kind of difficulty that Richard mentioned between, sort of, there are real benefits to more cohesion, more centralization, as opposed to creating veto points that then become opportunity points. And that, to my mind, is sort of roughly the transition from the old administrative law as envisioned in the APA itself to sort of the new administrative law as envisioned by Skelly Wright and his friends on the DC Circuit post 1970. Right? We paid a price for the old system. It was sort of closed. It had an intended tendency of superintending industry cartels, but at least what you didn't have was the system where if anybody can stroll into court any day of the week and sort of basically gain a property right in a piece of the administrative process, and then we try to sort it all out. And if you're optimistic, you call that reasoned deliberation. And if you're pessimistic, as I tend to be, it's just a holdout game all around. So it's the same trade-off. The reason why I'm bringing that up is not just to sort of flag the administrative state or whatever you want to call it, the regulatory state, as an issue, but also because I'm inclined to think, I'm not entirely sure about this, but I'm inclined to think that on that structural issue, so on Aziz's point, I thought the classical liberal constitution or paradigm actually had a determinate answer, and it's the 19th century answer. If you have private rights at stake, you get full-scale de novo review, and if you don't, you get nothing at all. And what we've replaced that with is sort of appellate review models of one sort or another, where sort of court become sort of adjuncts or appendices of the administrative agencies, and we argue about the standard of review until the lights go out. And that invariably sort of compromises, I think, classical liberal objectives and orientations, no matter which way you cut it. Thomas smiling because he's written a very famous article about this and says, come on, that game is up, we've lost it. Maybe that game is up too, but it's just sort of one thing I wanted to flag. And the final reason for flagging is it rests precisely on if I'm right about this, that sort of private rights, full-scale review or nothing, if you don't have a private right, that is really very different from the way Richard describes it. It hangs on those distinctions, all these Marbury-esque distinctions, and precisely not on, come on in, let's subject everything to judicial review.
Well, I'll build more, I guess, on Michael's comments, because that is an area, the administrative area, that I think does link to the kinds of issues we're discussing here. So a larger way I would put this point that I was trying to make about separation of powers is to at least raise questions about whether we have a kind of, I use the word romanticism about democracy in the United States that I think sometimes produces counterproductive effects because we think too little about how political power is actually organized and how power actually functions. And so, for example, if you take the administrative area, as you pointed out, it's not just doctrine, but built into the structure of the American administrative state is something quite dramatically different from the administrative state in other European democracies, or in the European democracies, for example, which is a tremendous amount of democratic control over the administrative process. We have much greater resistance to the ideas of a capacity for sort of independent expertise. You know, there was an era in which that held sway, as Michael said. We got very skeptical of it. And as a result, we have an administrative state that has so much more political control, which means so many more opportunities for very individualized interests to work with particular congressional committees or particular members of Congress to penetrate the administrative process. As a consequence of developments that are larger things that may have advantages, may have virtues, but this is one of the kinds of costs, I think. That's why I say Richard's book, because it made me want to see, well, what does a classical liberal have to say about the separation of powers? Is there some unique vision there, some unique theory or conception? Forced me back to some of these, I think, kind of foundational questions about institutional design. And I think that we want to penetrate a little bit more probingly behind the generalities of diffusion of power and their virtues to ask, how does power really work in a political system? What kinds of organization does or doesn't take place? What kinds of organizational structures are undermined or furthered by diffusing political power in certain ways or concentrating it in a way, let's say, closed-list proportional representation systems do? And I think that I like the link to the administrative process because I think it raises similar kinds of questions. Because we have such a strong tendency to believe that participation, more democratization of these processes is a good and desirable thing, I don't think we ask enough hard questions about whether institutionalizing those ideas actually undermines, in fact, many of the goals that many of us have. And I am not a classical liberal in Richard's sense, obviously, but many of us have for a productive, efficient, you know, well-structured set of political policies and outcomes. So I like that addition to the discussion. I embrace that as a friendly, as you put it, you know, suggestion.
Aziz?
This builds off the last two comments. I wonder whether a further structural question that a libertarian constitutional designer ought to care about is the amendment protocols for a constitution in the following sense. Both the concerns that Richard raised about the possibility of discrete veto gates serving as opportunities for rent-seeking, the concerns that Michael raised about administrative agencies are plausibly thought of as pathologies of democratic governance that are exacerbated over time as interest groups and powerful factions within society are able to identify and then seriatim exploit certain features of a system. We have a constitution that, as all know, amendment is almost impossible except for trivial housekeeping details. We've figured out ways of amending the constitution without changing the text. But consider what the value from the perspective taken by the liberal, the classical liberal constitution would be. Consider the value of an amendment protocol that made wholesale rearrangement of political structures more feasible. Wholesale rearrangement in ways that altered the upset or destabilized the calcification of interest groups, the possibility of capture of administrative agencies, prevented the kind of rent-seeking that in many of the comments seems to be a principal concern. It's not clear to me that it's necessarily the case that one would want the kind of Jeffersonian solution of a new constitution every 19 years. It may well be that the libertarian constitutional designer would, at the end of the day, decide that the capacity of or the opportunities for long-range planning, for investments and the settlement of investments that a stable constitution enable are more valuable than the losses due to capture and rent-seeking that have been described. But at least it seems to me the question is worth asking.
Yeah, as an economist, I'm not an equilibrium theorist who believes in the Pareto efficiency of competitive equilibrium as an end of history kind of document, rather think of historical processes as bound up in conflict that goes on eternally, and that political constitutions are concerned with a more with what you might call a structure of relationships among participants in that process, and then it's concerned with the imagery of contract. And so different structures of relationship that influence the properties of different kinds of political systems, which of course was recognized at our founding. That was part of the federal structure of governance. But it, there are various ways in, of practically a limitless number of ways in which you could design within the basic rubric of democratic governance a structure of that would have places for people to the exercise of power, and that's very much an open program of how that what the various possibilities are. There's a huge research program there that has a lot of room for developing, but whatever might be developed. I think one of the challenges, I think, for classical liberalism is to wrestle with the legacy of the German from the early 1920s, Carl Schmitt, that he was Carl Schmitt a classical liberal or not. Some people want to say that he wasn't. I think that he was. But sometimes you get the scheme sort of authoritarian liberalism attached to Carl Schmitt, which I think is okay. For those of you who don't know about Schmitt, he was a major jurist in Germany in the early 1920s and into the 1930s. He became a kind of a Nazi briefly for a 2-3 year period. Before he tried to get Chancellor Hindenburg to eject communists and Nazis from the government, and Hindenburg said he had no power to do that. And I think that points to the question of whether if the key word of liberalism is toleration, does that raise the notion, is there something intolerable to classical liberalism? Or is classical liberalism a system in which there are a framework outside of which becomes intolerable? If I think that points right at the present age. I think I think there are Liberty Fund, for instance, when it talks about liberty, that they go to great lengths to say that we have two things that are of concern to us: liberty and responsibility. We're talking of a society of liberal but responsible individuals, which raises a whole host of questions about what it is that responsible individuals means. And I think to my way of thinking, the opposite of this Faustian bargain idea I mentioned earlier is the idea of government as a dispenser of mana or largesse. I think that was what Charles Warren was anticipating back in 1932 when he spoke of Congress as Santa Claus. But the United States, of course, was founded on a total rejection of the feudalism that was part of the European experiment, where there you had lords and governance was their business versus one here where there were no such things as lords and government was everyone's business. And yet, Walter Eucken, going back to Germany in the 1930s and 40s, where you had an interesting law and economics movement between Eucken and Franz Boehm, he was concerned with what he called a refeudalization of the economy in various ways. And I think that refeudalization and its possibilities, I think, gets back to Carl Schmitt and the place of what I might call authoritarian liberalism. I think that can fit within classical liberalism, but it means that liberalism is a project that doesn't mean that anything goes, but it means that there are limits, I think, to liberal governance that actors within a liberal system need to somehow maintain, and it's not an easy thing.
Okay, thank you. Now we can move to the group, the audience here, for questions or comments. Yes. Matt, better introduce yourself for those who don't.
Tom Farrell, Columbia. very separation of powers minded panel altogether, the title was structure, and no one seems to have mentioned federalism. I thought it was one of the more interesting aspects of Richard's book. Maybe that there aren't any clear lines of connection between political premises and structures and separation of powers, but Richard has some very provocative ideas about federalism. He also likes the Dormant Commerce Clause, particularly the anti-discrimination principle, which says the simple idea, which is usually enforced by courts, that they promote economic competition. So, does anybody want to respond to Richard's ideas about federalism, which I think are, in many respects, avoid some of the criticisms of indeterminacy in the panel's emphasis with respect to self-determination?
I think that's Michael, is it?
Oh, God.
The reason that why I didn't pick up on that is that this interchange between Richard and myself in the book itself and, how shall I put this? It feels awkward that Richard is sitting there and I'm sitting here, so I'll say what I think about it and then walk away from it. I think it several things. One is that you have a much better chance of making sort of a somewhat court-heavy way of thinking stick on federalism than on separation of powers, because I think on sort of classic separation of powers, the Supreme Court has never played a really dominant role in American politics and law. On federalism, it has. So there, the payoff is much larger, and it's institutionally more plausible to my mind. So that's one thing. The second thing is that I by and large agree with Richard on the sort of normative orientation and the question of how the pieces fit together and whether there is a connection between federalism and classical liberal orientation. I think that's right. I have some of, I mean, and then I have some disagreements, and I'll just articulate them, and then people can sort of make of them what they will. The first thing is that I think lines like the commerce power or the enumerated powers are also parchment barriers. What you have to identify is somehow some political arrangement, some sort of real world constellation that makes those lines hold, so that in real life. So that's one thing. And the second thing is that I think the lines that Richard wants to draw, with which I have, again, full sympathy, will in real life crumble and simply cannot hold for a number of reasons. Why is it that very smart people on the Supreme Court thought they needed an original package doctrine? And the reason is you have to have something like that, you know, if you want to draw categorical lines between what's in state and what's no longer in state. Those doctrines didn't make much sense. 2 hours of oral argument about whether chicken have or have not come to rest also doesn't make much sense to me, but you need a doctrine like that as well. So an even larger point, I think, is this. I represent the socialist wing of GMU Law School. the median voter is Ilya, who is going to be up next. So I'll say it, I think Wickard versus Filburn was rightly decided. Why do I think that? There are only two options of saying it was wrong. Either you say the commerce power itself can only be used for pro-competitive purposes and to break down state-imposed barriers. I think that's wrong. But if you want to say that, then the commerce power or the limitations on the commerce power didn't die in 1937. They died in 1896 and probably much before then. If you don't want to say that and you can say, no, the power to regulate commerce is the power to restrict and maybe even prohibit it, then all you've left is a necessary and proper problem. And on that score, I think our sort of progressive foes, our common progressive foes are right in that particular case. That's a relatively clear case. There is an even deeper problem, and I'll mention this. And since you mentioned the dormant commerce power, I think the scope of the commerce power has to be the same on the dormant as on the affirmative side. Maybe you can fight that, but you'd fight it in the teeth of Camp's Newfound and, you know, a dozen other decisions. So as you contract the power of Congress on one side over commerce, you also contract the Supreme Court's authority to check abuses, state abuses, on the other side. The situation we have, I think, is the worst of all worlds. So the same day that they argued Bickert versus Filburn, they also argued Parker versus Brown. Parker versus Brown has a dormant commerce clause piece. This is the raisin case, and can they exploit the entire country on account of their monopoly position? And the Supreme Court says, sure, because California is only controlling or regulating the production of raisins and not their sale in interstate commerce, so they can cartelize the local commerce all they want. And so you have the categorical positions not working on the positive, affirmative side, but you have them working on the negative or dormant commerce clause side. That's the worst of all worlds. But I can't figure out a way out of the sort of basic dilemma of saying, you know, as you contract Congress's powers, you also contract the Supreme Court's power to lay waste to protectionist and exploitative state conduct. It's another one of these trade-offs that Richard alluded to, and I just don't see an easy way out.
Yeah, Gary.
Yeah, Gary Boston, Boston University. I actually want to go back to something that, Mario Rizzo said in his opening comments, and that was, how do you keep the various facets of constitutionalism in balance? Put it another way, what happens when they go out of balance? Introduce the administrative state. What that means, once you've done that, is that the entire structure of separation of powers goes into the boiler. It's gone. Done. Once that happens, what then? Is there an analogy in constitutionalism to economic theory of the second best? Once you're not in equilibrium, you said you're not in equilibrium and you're done. Right? Once you said the structure that has been set up, classical liberal or no, is no longer the structure, is there anything more to say, or are we simply done? Whatever you said.
We might be done. But I thought that the part of Richard's, at least in my view, motivation in bringing up a notion of a prescriptive constitution is the kind of second best. Okay, we have something that it was wrong, it was a mistake, it may have been terrible, but we've got to start from there, we've got to deal with it. And how can we deal with it in such a way as to preserve the basic liberal structure or liberal content of the Constitution? And so that involves keeping your eye on the general principles,
right, at the same time as you try to deal with a structure that you wouldn't have had in the first place if you had your way. And that's kind of, I thought, a kind of second best analysis. How effective that can be is a matter of debate, but it certainly does seem to deal with that issue, at least in general terms.
Could I say something about "are we done" comment? Because before the American constitutional experiment, it would have been presumed that democracies were done, that they were temporary forms of government. There was this famous statement for the Scottish historian Alexander Tytler to the effect that a democracy can only be a transitory form of government that can persist until majorities come to realize that they can vote themselves largesse at the expense of other people. And those kinds of images have always, I think, been in place. And there is a certain logic of faction that speaks in that direction. And these questions about how to prevent control, and so everybody, as it were, supports themselves rather than some being supported by other, I think is one of those very knotty problems that speaks to the Kant's point about the crooked timber of humanity. But we have to somehow try, I think we're engaged in an enterprise of trying to build something straight despite the crooked timber of the material with which we're working. And that's, I think, a never-ending progress. Maybe we are done, but none of us, I think, who's alive can really face up to that. We always want to do better than that, and I hope we can.
But you know, every about 25 years, it seems to me, that there is this complaint about, in the words of the James McGregor Burns book, the deadlock of democracy, that somehow we can't function, Congress can't decide things, important problems can't be solved, and we need a real leader, which scares me when I hear real leader. Recently, I think it was, I've forgotten who, but one commentator said, well, where's a Churchill now that we need him? I mean, you know, okay. So there, you know, there is every so often a real skepticism about the future of democracy, and with good reason, I think. But anyway,
sorry, just very briefly, there's the sort of, are we done practically? Is it all hopeless? That's a practical question. There's the other question, which I took you to ask, which is, should we think about second best rules? And there, I think I know what Richard's instinct is, and it would also be mine. I'm very, very skeptical about second best rules, because you never know where you're playing and whether you're making things worse. So there's a lot of constitutional and ad law scholarship now, people who think about second best rules and or compensating adjustments or whatever you want to call that. I'm deeply skeptical about it, and I think Richard is too.
Can I? Oh, you want to say something?
I just want to say, among economists, if you raise second best, they tell you to shut up. Because the same reason, because it's too murky, who knows. But on the other hand, it's where the world is.
And of course, a system of practical governance can't ignore the changing dynamics of the way a system functions over time. It would be bizarre in some sense to think it could or ought to. It depends on what kinds of objectives or, you know, policies one is trying to kind of readjust the system to realize. But I'll give you a concrete example, because I think about this issue a lot. You know, let's say you are a very strong believer in the idea of checks and balances, and you recognize that the system doesn't function in the way it was envisioned or may have operated for some period of time because of the rise of political parties and the way that transforms the relationship between these institutions. So I've suggested a couple of kinds of changes, second best changes, if you will, that you could think about. In terms of judicial doctrine, if that's where one wants to focus, I'm, by the way, skeptical that judicial doctrine is the main place to focus on for these kinds of structural adjustments. But if you want to focus on judicial doctrine, you could imagine that in separation of powers cases, where you're in the twilight zone and it's not clear if Congress has authorized or prohibited the presidential action, maybe doctrine tilts more against presidential action, at least in circumstances where the president's party controls the Congress, as a way of pushing Congress to play a role it's reluctant to play because it has partisan affiliations with the president, right? You could imagine adjusting doctrines in those sorts of ways. You know, more deeply in terms of structural changes outside of courts, you can imagine trying to create structures that are more common in European democracies that empower the opposition party in government in various forms. Because if the House and Senate isn't somehow this abstract vehicle for resisting the executive branch, the only resistance is likely to be mobilized effectively through the oppositional political party. So if they're a minority in government, they have no tools, they can't do anything with that opposition. You know, maybe you do things like create audit committees that are chaired by the opposing party, things like that. But I think your question, I think it's unavoidable that any system of practical governance has to deal with adjustments to the way institutions actually turn out to function and change in their functioning over time, and whether that adjustment comes through doctrine or not is a separate matter.
Ilya.
So I'm tempted to explain to Michael, Ilya Sobin, George Mason University. I'm tempted to explain to Michael why Wickard versus Boburn is wrong, and not only wrong, but badly wrong, at least in terms of text original meaning. But instead, I'll ask the actual question I was going to ask, which is primarily for written abilities and possibly disease, and that is, you suggest that maybe what we want to prevent rent-seeking behavior, interest groups, particularly in the political process, is strong parties and more independent administrative agencies. But it's not clear to me, even as a theoretical matter, that that necessarily follows, because in countries which have stronger parties, the interest groups are often just directly built into the party structure, as, for instance, labor unions and certain kinds of business interests are in many European democracies. And similarly, many seemingly independent agencies, what that just means is the interests inside the agency are the ones that actually control things rather than they promote the public good in a disinterested way. So I was wondering if you could articulate your model a little bit more. I'm not saying necessarily that means we should have weak parties. I think that's a complex matter, whether we should or not. But it seems to me that having stronger ones doesn't necessarily mean less interest group influence. And similarly, with stronger and more independent administrative agencies, it might just change the channels through which the influence flows.
First,
I think I don't think that anything I said was inconsistent with that claim.
Okay, so. At least with respect to, let's say, the larger issue, the political parties and governance structures, it's of course true that the democratic systems are going to be responsive, and appropriately so, I would say, to, you know, large-scale mobilized interest and preferences. I'm not sure what the alternative vision is. There are side constraints about rights and the like we can worry about. But I mean, fundamentally, the idea that governments are responsive and that can't be the problem. So the thing I'm concerned about is, as I say, the sort of minoritarian kinds of manipulations of democratic systems in which relatively small but intensely interested, concentrated groups with concentrated interests and organization and resources are able to exploit the system. And so what I'd be interested in, and I don't know that there's literature on this, but, you know, comparative assessment of, let's say, the tax code, the taxation system, and the number of specialized single sector exemptions and the like in parliamentary systems, or parliamentary systems designed in one way versus another, like PR, strong closed list PR systems versus our kind of system, right? That's, to me, those are the kinds of questions that would test the extent to which one of these kinds of structures more successfully does or doesn't resist the kind of carving up by minority special interest groups that we know is endemic to all democracies as a risk. But I think a system, at least I'm raising the question, whether a system that creates so many points of access, veto, potential extortion from the other side, and manipulation is much more prone to those kinds of forces, and whether the fear of governmental power that underlies the original design turns out to be, as I say, counterproductive from the this at least from this particular perspective, with respect to the capacity of the system to resist this kind of carving up by minority special interests, rent-seeking sorts of groups. So, you know, if your concern is that the Labour Party in England is, you know, deeply tied to the union world and historically was, I'm not going to be sympathetic to you on that, because that's a mass mobilization. Whatever the right policies are, that's mass mobilization politics. And I thought you were going to say something else, which is that you and Richard would say the answer to my concerns is just shrink the government down as much as possible, because that's the way to, right, okay.
But that's an argument, not a question.
Okay.
That's
okay.
A given.
That's good. And that means Richard can't make that point since it's been flagged, so.
Can I add just one thing to that? So, you know, one way, the question is, I think, useful because it points to an additional complication, or it points to two additional complications, one of which is the question about how to aggregate different kinds of values synchronically. And the other one is the way in which the bundling of issues affects design choices in different domains. So on the first, one way of thinking about Richard's presentation is the observation that parties can be forums for the resolution of political coalitions in ways that either raise or lower the transaction costs of rent seeking. And in some instances, a party might be a barrier to rent seeking, but I think your point is that in some instances the party can itself provide the forum for in which different factions can negotiate a coalition that actually engages in better rent seeking, right? And that's surely right. And the relative cost of rent seeking within versus outside a party for the libertarian constitutionalist ought to be a metric or a factor that they take into account. The complication, or the interesting complication, is that the party example in particular brings to light the possibility of multiple primary goods or values being at stake in a constitutional design decision. So as Richard's answer brought out, it may well be that a party, such as the British Labour Party or German parties that have social democratic roots, are, on the one hand, vehicles for more efficient rent-seeking, but on the other hand, they're also vehicles for more efficient realization of mass participation in national democratic structures in the absence of other mediating institutions between the local and the national level, and therefore are vehicles for the achievement of another value that a libertarian would want, which is, or some, maybe not you, but some other libertarians would want, which is a form of political liberty, right? And so the question about parties and the interaction between the design of the democratic system and fiscal outcomes, I would suggest, is more complicated for the libertarian, because that unit of analysis, the party structure, is going to impact two things that they care about. The smaller point with respect to the two things that you mentioned, the party political system and the question about agencies, is notice that there's an important difference with respect to the dynamics of rent-seeking across those two institutional landscapes. By and large, parties are institutions in which, perforce, there is a bundling across different issues such that the party has to have a platform, right? They have to have views on a whole bunch of different policy questions. The administrative state, such as we have it, again, by and large, is a landscape in which issues are segregated, such that if you wanted to raise an objection or pursue an environmental policy, you go to the EPA. If you want a policy with respect to transportation, you go to the Department of Transportation. The relative costs of rent-seeking, of inefficient, the production from the libertarian perspective, inefficient regulation is going to differ depending upon the interaction between whatever interest groups are out there in the world and the bundled versus disaggregated nature of the channels of institutional choice. And again, your question is, I think, inadvertently or advertently, pointing to another design dimension that I think is awfully tricky for our libertarian constitutional designers to navigate.
Okay, we have time now for Richard to make some response. So, and then after that, we're going to have lunch. Do you want to come up and take my seat here?
No, I'll stand.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. These are really sort of wonderful criticisms. They aren't in any ways effective. What I'm going to sort of do is sort of go down the row, I think, in some reasonably coherent fashion, because alphabetical order and sort of structural interests seem to me in many cases to parallel one another. and so what happens is the first question that was raised was the one that was raised by Michael Grieber, which is, why did I put the stuff on the judicial stuff before the other stuff? It's actually a very good question to which I do not have a perfect answer. One of the ways to do it is to simply treat the Constitution as 1, 2, and 3, start with the legislative, then go to the executive, and then go to the judicial power, because that's the way they organized it. I think I chose the other organization because the sort of the evolution of American constitutional law begins most importantly with those great cases of having to do with Marbury and Madison and Martin and Hunter's lessee. And so immediately we start to see the courts shaping the way in which the Constitution has been interpreted. And I sort of follow the historical pattern rather than the structural pattern. Now that Michael mentions it, I'm not so sure that if I had to do the book again that I would do it in exactly this way. So the second edition might actually follow the text a bit more literally. But that having been said, the question then is, how does one make sense out of this if, in fact, you start with that order? And one of the things I'd like to do is to sort of ask the question, which I think is implicit in virtually everything that everybody has said here, is the extent to which you could start to use private models of governance to try to tell you something about the way in which public models of governance ought, in a coherent fashion, to work. This is not an easy question to answer. I mean, the first thing, of course, about it is to the extent that you do get these voluntary organizations, they're telling you something, because by and large, if they tend to exhibit a common pattern to deal with collective goods, chances are, if they're voluntary, if they're replicated in large numbers of different places with very large numbers of different kinds of ends and views, they're probably doing something right, because otherwise the forms would not survive in their current form. And so what happens is, if you start to look at these corporations, there are, I think, the sort of three parts. One is that you certainly do have shareholders who kind of count as the citizens. Then you put together the board of directors who are supposed to direct general policy on the grounds that citizens cannot do it themselves. And then you get yourself a chief executive officer and a staff which is supposed to implement those particular policies, because you cannot expect either the diffuse shareholders on the one hand or the board of directors on the other to engage in those kinds of activities. So it seems to me that anybody who thinks that you could kind of run a government without having these three parts is, I think, going to be sadly mistaken at the public or the private level. Just the question is how it is that you put them together. And one of the discussions that we had was about the relationships of parliamentary structures on the one hand to presidential structures. And I think it's clear to say that in some extent the parliamentary structures in which the prime minister can be removed by majority vote without impeachment or something of that particular sort is in fact perhaps closer to the way in which corporations organize. And so what you then have to do is to immediately ask yourself, if you're going to switch to the independent presidential system for whatever political reasons you think, what are you going to have to do to offset that particular change in the way in which the rest of the operation is put together? I don't think of this as a second best kind of a judgment, but I do think in effect that once you have this very, very powerful president, you're not going to be surprised to see that you're going to have restrictions on the way in which the president can appoint various kinds of subordinate offices. If you don't have the ability to dump the president instantaneously, you're going to want some kind of check, perhaps through the Senate, on the appointment of key officials. You're then going to have some very difficult questions associated with the appointments clause with respect to people who are lower down in the hierarchy. And one of the things, of course, that's so difficult in our current Constitution is that the scale issues matter a great deal. If you're talking about a relatively small government, you may have relatively few appointments, but the moment you start having large numbers of administrative agencies and you try to run that through an appointments process, which is going to have the Senate having to deliberate each and every one of these cases, you're going to get the kinds of roadblocks which will become very difficult, whereupon you will see, as we have seen, that the courts themselves will start to make more and more people inferior offices, precisely because what they're trying to do is to avoid the kinds of log jams that come when you have a series of institutions that are not fully scalable in the way in which they start to operate. And I think one of the really serious problems, of course, about American constitutional law is that corporate structures are not easily scalable. As you start to multiply a government, you know, by populations of 25 and 30 and government size by as much as 100, you're going to have to see much more put into the internal administrative structure to handle these kinds of things, because if you just simply try to keep the relatively lean structures that you have for a small nation and a modest government in place, when you start to make things much more extensive and much more vast, it's simply not going to work. The whole administrative structure will collapse. But having said that, we then start to get to the question of whether or not the standing doctrine, which I think was the second thing that Michael raised, is in fact going to be appropriate as one of these devices. And I look at the standing doctrine, both textually and I think structurally, as an essential portion of a system, because you have to understand what you're trying to do with it. You're not trying to say that the standing doctrine allows any citizen to challenge any action by any government at any time. The key feature with respect to the early analysis was that when you start to deal with standing, can you challenge as a single citizen those actions which are ultra vires, the election or the political, the legislative branch on the one hand, or the executive branch on the other hand? And, you know, if you then look at the constitutional text, which was not discussed here, it says the judicial power shall extend to all cases in law and equity. And those terms actually carry a great deal of meaning, because the notion of equitable jurisdiction, as understood at the founding time, was to cover exactly those cases where there were diffuse wrongs to an organization and no single individual had a distinctive place with respect to it. And so the derivative action on behalf of all the shareholders was essentially designed to say this particular action was ultra vires the corporation. It's not, therefore, a matter of majority will as to what is to going on. It's keeping the contract. And if you breach a contract, one person is entitled to protest it, even if the other people are willing to go along with it, unless, of course, there's some kind of a formal amendment. And what has happened in the American constitutional system is the equitable part of this jurisdiction of the court is simply disregarded in the way in which we put together the standing situation. And when this happens, many things follow from it. So the first thing about it is that you cannot, therefore, challenge the corporate systems under the current structure, even though if you start to look back at where state governments go, they do follow the corporate analogy under these circumstances. And one of the most distinctive features about the Sutherland opinion in the Frothingham and in the Mellon cases, right, was the situation that why it was that those particular state precedents did not apply at the federal level. And he gave exactly the wrong answer. He said, as the numbers start to get larger, you can't have standing cases. But it's exactly the other way. As the numbers get larger, the ability to coordinate an attack is going to become much more difficult. So allowing the derivative action in many ways becomes more important as the numbers become larger rather than less important. And if it turns out that there are multiple people who want to bring these kinds of suits, the way to handle it is through multi-state litigation, and you coordinate the litigation. You don't shut it all off at one time or another. Now, does this really make a difference? Well, it does, because remember the first case that we had on standing was the Mellon case dealing with the question as to whether or not you could make transfer payments consistent with the structure of the basic taxing power of the United States. And if you try to talk about really profound public limitations, which was not mentioned here, the basic argument when you start talking about having a taxing power that starts to deal with the public debt, with the common defense, and with the general welfare of the United States asks this particular question. Is that structure consistent with notions of individual transfer payments between one group of persons and another within a society? And I spend a long time in the book trying to argue that it is not. In fact, that the previous understandings of the subject had always ruled these things out. And the real difficult questions of interpretation for which you're going to get lots of disagreements is whether or not sort of public benefits like fixing up roads or bridges in the events of hurricanes could be done for local kinds of accidents or whether they could only be done for national kinds of accidents. And even if you allow them for local kinds of accidents, what happens is you're still not having the taxing power and the transfer power being used. You are necessarily limiting the way in which public funds could be used to responding to these kinds of disasters. So you don't end up with anything that looks remotely like the Matrimonial Act of 1921, which was sustained by this thing. Now, this makes a huge difference in terms of the rest of the structure, because one of the things I think that Rick mentioned, which I want to sort of stress much more importantly, is that the ability of separation of power devices, whatever they may be and however they may be optimal, to deal with the kinds of very difficult questions that you have, clearly is a direct function of the amount of pressure that is going to be put on them. And the amount of pressure that is going to be put on them is going to be a function of the indefinite nature of the rights that you happen to have in political solution. So once you decide that transfer payments are now fair game, without having any constitutional deliberation on that fact, what's going to happen is they're going to be either pressure points or veto points of one sort or another, but they're going to be interest groups that are going to coalesce around trying to figure out how it is that you could organize these things, either to get them for themselves or to block them from everybody else. And if you start looking at the original constitutional structure, for about 140 years, we managed to avoid all of that problem. Nobody tried to do this thing, and then now that it's tried, it turns out that nobody has standing to stop it. You can say, of course, to Ms. Frothingham, you don't like it, just withdraw. But of course, she's not trying to say, I want to get my own money out of it so that, you know, or rather, I don't want to take the benefits. What I'm worried about is forcing the contributions in. And if I drop out on the benefit side, it's a perfect prison of dilemma game, because all that money is going to go to every other state. And so what you need to do is to find a way to stop the program rather than to say that you could get out of this on the benefit side. And once you can start by the taxing power to limit the size of the federal government, then in effect the opportunities for transfer payments start to be reduced so that whatever safety devices that you can put into place are going to be more effective by virtue of the fact that they have less to do. And so this essentially starts to point out the way the standing doctrine, the taxing power, and the indefinite nature of property rights starts to bring you in line with the public choice perspective, that essentially the ability to gain rents or to dump liabilities on somebody else is something that you're very leery of, which is why it is when the founders talked about this in 1787, they were very, took great pains to distinguish between a Republican form of government and a Democratic form of government. That was, by the way, completely in line with political philosophy at the time, including stuff written on public powers by Immanuel Kant at exactly this kind of period. By 1800, it's all completely gone in the great battle over the Democratic Republicans and the election of 1800, which I think did mark a very important change in government. But there is no question that they did not think of popular representation and full democratic participation as a correct goal, precisely because of the way in which majorities could effectively change situations through transfer payments, the manipulation of liability rules, and so forth. So when Rick talks about the English Labour Party, it is an unmitigated disaster. If you go back and you read the Trade Disputes Act of 1906, in which what they did essentially was not to make any direct cash transfer to each other, but they announced that their contracts could not be enforced against them, that they could not be held responsible for inducement of breach of contract, and most importantly, that a collective refusal to deal was completely outside the scope of anything that the courts or anybody else can superintend if the only actions they did were the actions that a single person could do without attracting liability, which meant, in effect, that the standard Sherman Act violations of respective collective refusal to deal now, in effect, become perfectly protected. And it took a major constitutional convulsion until some of this stuff was not eliminated but softened under Margaret Thatcher. But the interim losses in productivity in England by virtue of that statute alone, coupled with all of the collateral institutions that developed around it, marks one of the great failures of democratic institutions. And in the United States, we did not go as far or as furious in that direction, but it is instructive to note that in 1908, we did apply the antitrust laws with respect to unions in the Danbury Hatters case. And then what we did is we created through legislation the exemption under the Clayton Act in 1914, which was in response to one of the major issues that was associated with the 1912 election. And so the notion that what you really want to do is to have a kind of fragmented government that doesn't allow for direct participation to measure itself in political circles is, in my view, a sound one, because it's the only way in which what you can do is to stop the kinds of destructive struggles that will take place and result in serious losses. People often ask me, what do you think about the New Deal? And I said, look, there are two kinds of programs you have to worry about. One of the silly spending programs, and frankly, those don't trouble me all that much, particularly when you have, after Hoover, very high tax rates. Either you get public expenditures, or you're going to have complete stagnation in the economy. So I think in that regard, Roosevelt did not do the wrong thing and may have well done the right thing. Of course, his willingness to keep the taxes high was a different proposition, but at least given that. But on the other hand, the creation of the various kinds of cartel mechanism that were put into place at that period, in agriculture and labor, motor vehicles, automotive stuff, airlines and so on, Fair Labor Standards Act, that stuff lasts 40, 50, 60 years, and it all has clear efficiency properties that are demonstrably negative. So, for example, when Michael talked about the whole situation with Parker v. Brown coming down the same year as Wickard and Filburn, actually they decided in different years but argued the same days. Parker is the situation in which they exempt from the application of the antitrust laws a basically a conspiracy against trade, which is sanctioned by the state government. And what we know from economic theory is if you've got a cartel which is backed by state power, it becomes stable rather than unstable, so it's more dangerous rather than less dangerous to the union. And it was this peculiar New Deal attitude on this particular subject, which says that the government has the complete right to decide whether we want cartels or competition as a structural matter in industry. That led the court to take deference to California, even though, as Michael pointed out, most of the negative effects that you had turn out to take place outside the particular state in question. And the classical liberal was somebody who did not leave these kinds of judgments about industrial structure essentially to the political branches because it was too dangerous. And essentially what the courts tried to do was to promote in whatever way they could see fit various kinds of competitive mechanism. And on the antitrust laws, with the exception of the deference from cases like Parker and Brown, if you read some of the earlier cases, they're amazingly good at the way in which they applied the antitrust laws, just as they were amazingly good in the way in which they applied rate regulation to deal with these things. So I think, in effect, that the standing rules in order to enforce, for example, the tax provisions are one of the great stories. And this, by the way, is before 1937, Richard. These are cases in the 1920s in which there was a major decline of classical liberal principles. Those two cases are part of it. Block v. Hirsch, which sustained rent control on completely preposterous grounds in New York, with Holmes' opinion, was another one of these things. Euclid against Ambler, which got everything wrong with respect to the zoning type situation in 1926, was another one. Blaisdell, which sort of messed up the entire situations with respect to mortgages in 1934, was yet another state. New state, Ice versus Lieberman, you get all these problems about dealing with state monopolies and so forth. You have a lot of things going down. The taxation issues all sort of went south in the mid part of the 1920s or 1915 with Brush Harbor. One of the things that the classical liberal position takes structurally is the only tax which is politically stable in the long run is a flat tax from first to last, because otherwise you get exactly the same kinds of struggles that we've now witnessed today. And you know, people start talking about the great benefits that you get in terms of higher equity, but the productive loss is indirect but very real that comes from the instability of tax structures, like the instability of property rights and the instability of liability rules, is something which is very important. Now, the next point
Richard,
is...
Richard, what? Your time is kind of off.
Oh, give me 5 more minutes. 5 minutes.
Okay, all right. Gotcha. All right.
I mean, I just wanted to only do very quickly, minutes. I mean, one of the other problems, on this, I will stop at this one, is the question, is there an orthogonal relationship between liberty and constitutional structures, which is what Aziz was talking about. The reason the problem is more difficult than one might have thought is that a classical liberal constitution starts with a presumption of liberty, but recognizes that more complicated administrative actions have to be taken into place to deal with a number of serious problems, like common pool problems on the one hand, rate regulation on the other hand, internet industries of one kind or another, and so forth. And you can't use a libertarian government to do these things because they're not large enough or robust enough to be able to do the administrative stuff that's one way or another. And so either you need to have independent agencies or very large executive branches. So the basic point that one wants to make about all of this is that once you understand those particular elements, then you can see why it is that the rise of the administrative state becomes extremely important when these large-scale industries take place. And the one point that I would stress, which was not discussed here, is whatever you want to do to live with administrative agencies, it's a lot easier to do if you have two things. One, a system of strong property rights so that you can worry about the compensation issue directly. And secondly, what you clearly have to do, in my judgment, is to break off the adjudicative functions out of the administrative agencies, like the NLRB and the SEC and so forth, because they become hopelessly partisan. And we know it to be such when the president's party gets the majority in one way or another. And there's no reason why it is that administrative efficiency requires you to do that. Once you change that, you can now change the complications associated with recess appointments, in which the appropriate rule is to give the president greater discretion over administrative branches, but not to do it with respect to adjudicative kinds of bodies. And so what's really happened is the whole thing kind of comes clattering down. And even though you may not be able to make, and I'm going to finish on this point, a precise analysis of the way in which you want to deal with separation of powers, if you get the Commerce Clause stuff right, the tax powers right, Tom said, and so forth, it turns out that the system is much more coherent than the one we have. So I'll stop at that. Thank you.
Okay.